Purpose today is to talk about Plato's understanding of virtue and the nature of the well-ordered soul in the Republic, or at least particularly from the Republic. I'll be referring to other dialogues of Plato's to try to make sense of some of it. But I need to start off by describing how difficult this task is. It's difficult for at least two different reasons. One of those is our misunderstanding about what virtue is. And the other one has to do with how Plato is largely misunderstood. Without speaking for several hours on these, I don't think I can explain all of these ideas, the confusions and the sources. But I'm going to start off by just offering two general problems or descriptions of these problems. Our view of virtue, first of all, has become confused with obedience to law. And we get this from even when we talk about virtue. Virtue has to do with, it's largely connected with sexual virtue, restraining from those desires. And so the original view of virtue among the Greeks is difficult for us to comprehend. Elizabeth Anscombe, in a famous paper from the 1950s entitled Modern Moral Philosophy, made this very argument that we when we try to talk about Aristotelian virtue, we don't know what we're talking about. And she, who is a Christian, was a Christian, blamed 1,000 years of Christianity and the Christian emphasis on the moral law for our inability to understand Aristotle and understand Greek virtue. The main problem is that we can only think of good and evil in terms of a law that stands over against our nature. And virtue is dutiful obedience to a law that's distinct from our nature. I'll be talking more about that later on in the talk. And despite my own appreciation for Christianity, I think she might have been right, and this applies to our misunderstanding of what's going on in Plato as well. The other problem is the standard way of approaching Plato by scholars. As someone who spent a lot of time studying Plato, I have to be really arrogant and declare that I am the one who understands him correctly and everyone else gets him wrong, and so this is the part where I do that. But I'm going to try to give evidence for my view as we go through this, because it says a lot about what Plato is talking about with his virtue. And so I think there are two bad assumptions that we have about Plato. The first is the attempt to date his writings. If you know anything about Plato, we try to date his writings in terms of early, middle, and late. The early are supposed to be more historically accurate to who Socrates is, and as you go on into later dialogues, you start to get Plato's own developed thought. And so early on, he's just kind of recording more what Socrates actually did. As you go on, Plato starts figuring out all the answers to the questions and starts writing more complicated dialogues with all those answers. I can't go into the details, but there's a great article by a guy named Jacob Howland called Rereading Plato, The Problem of Platonic Chronology, where he basically offers a fatal criticism to this view. Our view for dating it, the external evidence is essentially non-existent, and the internal evidence suffers from some pretty vicious question begging. And so, I could go into details, but I don't want to go off on that too much. But there is some support for why they might think this, and that is that it seems like Socrates in the different dialogues disagrees with himself. He has contradictory views. For example, in the Apology, when he's defending himself before the Athenian jury, defending himself very poorly, he claims that he doesn't know whether there's such thing as an afterlife. He's not sure. It could be that either it's basically a dreamless sleep, or there could be an afterlife. Either way, it's a benefit. Then, a very short time later in the Phaedo, when he's about to the dialogue that describes his death with his friends, he argues quite poorly, actually, but he argues for life after death, and he insists that it's the case with his friends. Why this change of point of view? And the belief generally is that the Apology is a fairly early work where Plato didn't know the answer, and so he's just recording what Socrates claims to ignorance. He says, well, Socrates is ignorant. I'm just showing you what Socrates is like. And then the Phaedo would be a late work where Plato's announcing his own ideas, just using Socrates as his mouthpiece. I think that's wrong. I think it's the wrong way to understand Plato. And this actually brings us directly to the second bad assumption. Scholars, despite their glowing genuflections toward the the dialogical form. Plato's writing in dialogues. They proceed to read Plato as if he's simply writing down his own ideas. But instead of being a good, you know, a decent philosopher and writing a treatise, he hides his ideas among this cumbersome but kind of pretty dialogue form. And so they claim the dialogue is really, really important, and then they proceed to interpret it as if it's not a dialogue. In a dialogue, there's a drama, there's characters, and those things matter for our interpretation of what's actually taking place. Why are these words being said? Well, you have to pay attention to the characters. And if I want to be, but if I want to be lazy in my interpretation, I simply ignore the fact that there are characters. I take Socrates as the good guy with the right ideas. I get rid of all the other stuff, and I just announce what Socrates says as Plato's ideas. Or if I read the Timaeus, Timaeus's ideas, since Socrates doesn't say much in the Timaeus. And in the Laws, the Athenian stranger, since Socrates isn't even in the Laws. And so, again, I think that's a failure to understand it, and there have been people who have written about this as well, particularly a guy named Drew Hyland who wrote specifically about this and described the Crito. So let me give you an example talking about the Apology. In the Apology, or comparing the view, Socrates' view of death in the Apology or the afterlife in the Apology with that in the Phaedrus, it could be that those different views can be explained in terms of the characters and the events. For example, we can compare this to Scripture, right? Jesus tells the rich young ruler to sell everything he has and give it to the poor. Does that mean everyone is supposed to sell everything they have and give to the poor? Or is that because of the particular character of the rich young man? Well, if Jesus is telling everyone who follows him to sell everything and give to the poor, Lazarus failed, and he's held in high regard for what he did, but he didn't sell everything and give to the poor, and we haven't either. So we normally interpret that in terms of the rich young ruler's own issues, not as a law where we just exclude the rich young ruler and take that as a law, right? We should probably do the same thing with Plato. And in the Phaedrus, in the Phaedo and the Apology, Socrates is dealing with two different situations, particularly the Phaedo. He's talking with a group of friends who are about to lose hope in philosophy because their philosopher, the greatest man they know, the greatest philosopher they know, is dying. And so they're not going to pursue virtue. They're not going to do it because the people hate it and they will kill you, right? So what does he say? You know, if you do philosophy, you're going to get a good life after death. And that'll encourage, right? And that's a really cheap, quick, rough outline, but it could be that that's what's actually happening. So we have a problem understanding virtue because we can generally only think of virtue in terms of moral law, which culminates in something like the deontological ethics of Immanuel Kant, which I'm sure everyone enjoys. And we have a problem understanding Plato because we generally ignore the dialogue form. And in order to harmonize contradictions, we just say Plato's thought developed and so forth. I believe these ideas are all tied together, and I'm going to try to show that by the end of this talk. And they're difficult to overcome in our minds. So while I'm really just talking about virtue, the well-ordered soul, and Plato's Republic in this talk, which is quite a bit already, I'm also going to be fighting against these ideas to describe what Plato is saying. Okay? So now let me actually start talking about virtue. Justice, which is the Greek is the same word for righteousness as dikaiosune. Justice in the, or it's the same word for righteousness in the New Testament, right? Justice is the topic of the Republic. And as you might guess, I think most people misunderstand what justice is in the Republic. It's kind of a dry, dead thing that's about as inspiring as watching paint dry, I guess. I don't think that's actually the case. I think what is being described in the Republic is actually very inspiring and exciting. And I'm going to try to convince you by the end of this that that's the case. How many of you are familiar at all with the Republic? Maybe you read it or you've studied it a little bit. Somebody who passed their classes. Okay, I got you. If you know much of anything about the Republic, you probably know about the tripartite soul. I mean, you probably know the myth of the cave and then maybe something about the divided line. But one of the central aspects of what's going on in the Republic is the tripartite soul. That our souls, that is who we are, is made up of three different parts, which are reflected in the three parts of the city that they describe in the dialogue. What are these three parts? By the way, they're describing a city because they want to know what justice looks like in an individual. And so they describe a city, a just city, so they can see what a just individual looks like because a just city is like an individual made large. There's maybe some, that might sound a little strange, but if we go into the details of Plato's ideas, I could argue for why that works. Nevertheless, they describe the three parts of the city, and those correspond to the three parts of the human soul. The three parts of the city are the guardians, the auxiliaries, and the normal everyday citizens, which I'll just call the producers. The producers are the workers, including blue and white collar workers, everybody from factory workers and miners to people who work banks and trade and so on and so forth. The guardians are at the top. So the producers are at the bottom. The guardians are the top, and those are the philosopher kings, because everybody knows that society will only be good when philosophers reign. Can I get an amen? So those are the ones who run the city rationally. And the auxiliaries are this middle ground. They're kind of the military and police force. They go to war and they enforce the will of the guardians on the producers, help kind of keep them in line. And of course, as you might guess, the guardians represent our rational minds. The producers represent our appetites, our desires for food and money and sex and those sorts of things. The auxiliaries represent our sense of honor and shame, our desire for victory and respect. And so the cardinal virtues are thus laid out in Book 4 of the Republic with this tripartite schema, kind of the four cardinal virtues of wisdom, courage, moderation, and justice. Wisdom is the amount of awareness of the good that the rational mind has. So you are wise insofar as the guardians know the good, insofar as your rational mind gets the good. Courage is located in the spirited part, or the auxiliaries area, right? How much, really, whether they know whether to fear or whether they know the right things to fear. So it is more important to fear dishonor than it is death, for example. And that's what courage is. Courage is not having no fear, but it's fearing the right things. And they would fear dishonor more than they would fear death. Moderation, the Greek sophrosune, which is a tricky word, we usually translate it moderation or self-control, is the control of the appetites by the rational through use of the spirited. Right? So my rational mind controls my appetites by use of shame, right? Keeps them in line. Justice is then what's left over, and that's that each part remains where it's supposed to be. The appetites remain on the bottom. They give information about whether we should be alive or not, or what we need to do to live. The auxiliaries remain obedient to the rational. That is, your desire for respect and honor remains obedient to the rational, and the rational rules. That's what it means to be a just person then, right? It's pretty straightforward understanding of it. And so a just person is one who uses their rational mind to control their appetites through the use of shame and the desire for respect. It shouldn't be surprising that Socrates would claim, as he makes very clear in the Republic, that this form of justice is highly unstable. And it will inevitably decay into ever more unjust orders. If you read closely, you realize very quickly that the reason that this form of justice, which he calls aristocracy, the rule by the best, decays into democracy, which is ruled by the honor-loving, then oligarchy, ruled by the money lovers, then democracy, which is the second most unjust form of government, which that makes you hate Plato, and that's ruled by whatever desire happens to pop up at the time, and then falls into tyranny. The reason this inevitably decays is because the desires within the city are not satisfied. They're simply constrained by force. Honor overthrows reason because being rational does not give enough honor. The appetites overthrow honor because honor grants neither enough money nor the fulfillment of the various bodily desires that we have. And so on and so forth until we're led to a tyranny, which is a tyranny is something like addiction. Eventually, because our desires are constrained and we're not fulfilled, the different forms of government keep getting overthrown, and the order within our souls keep getting overthrown because we are never satisfied. And so, in short, this form of justice is unstable because while one may know of the good in a rational way, one never comes close enough to it to be satisfied. And so the spirit and the appetites are always threatening to rebel. Now let me talk about us a little bit to see what this looks like. So most of us, I think in our experience, it reflects this a little bit in our experience of trying to be a good person. It is fear of shame that keeps our desires in line. We ourselves, we really desire all the looseness of the morals of our society. But we work hard to look down upon those morals so that and shame the sins of those around us so that we can maintain our unstable righteousness, right? So I maintain my righteousness by scoffing and deriding the looseness of those people that I'm jealous of, right? We all hate Trump, not because of what he said and did, but because we can't do that. But we pretend like we hate him for what he did so that we can maintain, right? Now, maybe that's a little bit extreme, but this is kind of the feeling we have, and so we're always battling our desires. We're always trying to maintain them through rational force and through shame, right? And the best kind of shame we have is the society around us. We surround ourselves with good people who will really look down on us if we do that sort of thing. In fact, Thucydides, I believe, criticized Sparta, their attempt to make an empire at the end of the Peloponnesian War, because when they tried to export their lifestyle, nobody would take it. And when they tried to take their leaders from Sparta and put them in other places, well, Sparta was a very shame-centered culture, right? They were really regimented. And when once these guys would go out and start ruling over a city where they didn't have that kind of culture and nobody was looking, they completely just decayed into the same sort of vice as the city they were living in. And so Sparta could never function that way. And I think that's kind of what we experience. And this is what Socrates' interlocutors in the Republic throw at him to try to get him to convince him that justice is a good thing. They actually say, let's imagine a scenario where you won't experience any shame. And so you remember the story of the Ring of Gyges is what it's often called, right? It sounds like Lord of the Rings, sort of. There's a lowly shepherd who finds a ring, and he discovers when he turns the setting in toward himself, he goes invisible. He's like, wow, I've been invisibility days before infrared and fingerprints and stuff like that. I can do anything I want. And so he seduces the queen. I don't know how being invisible seduces anyone, but he seduces the queen, kills the king, and takes over, right? The ultimate injustice. He destroys the rightful ruler. And the point is, if you had that capacity, if you had the capacity to act without concern for consequences, what would you do? What kind of life would you lead? And their view was justice is not joyful in itself. It's not good in itself. It does not make you happy. It's just what you get out of it, right? We're just because that's what everyone demands. And if I'm not just, people will hate me and I'll be excluded from society. And Adamantus actually adds to that. Glaucon and Adamantus are the two major interlocutors here. They're both Plato's brothers. Adamantus actually adds, if we compare an unjust person and a just person and we say the just person doesn't even get the benefits of God, right? Because we might say, well, you can turn the ring invisible, but God's still watching. Adamantus takes away the afterlife and says, you got to exclude that benefit too, right? Because we will say, well, no, I'm not going to do it because I know God's watching and I'm going to go to hell if I do that, or I'm going to lose jewels in my crown or whatever we lose. And Adamantus takes that away and says, is justice actually something that you love? Is righteousness something actually good? Do we love it? And the description in the Republic that comes out doesn't sound that good, right? It's based on shame, using the rational mind to shame the appetites into control. So does being righteous make you happy now? Or does it only make you happy if and when you get your payday for being righteous? If the latter, then we will never achieve anything like stable virtue, because what we're doing is we're just saving up for retirement, right? But we still want to spend the money now. In fact, we want to do that later, but we're trying to hold back so we'll be able to do that fun stuff later. In fact, at the beginning we have this image of Cephalus, who can't get involved in philosophy, which is interesting. He goes away to sacrifice to the gods, and he can't carry on conversation with Socrates. He is the one who has lost all of his appetites, all of his desires, and so he's kind of heralded as this good guy. But Socrates actually, I mean, Plato clearly rejects him because Cephalus will not carry on a philosophical conversation. And philosophy is the key to Plato. So we think we'll achieve stable virtue when we stop wanting stuff, which Nietzsche says that's actually desiring death, which I think is interesting. So are there clues in Plato's works to a virtue that overcomes this challenge, right? Are y'all getting the problem with stability and the fact that we're unsatisfied? We're perpetually unsatisfied. Are there clues to virtue where Socrates actually is telling them how to achieve a stable virtue? One that doesn't leave us in a divided, unstable state, but actually lets us be happy so that if we found the ring of Gyges, we would remain just. Well, our first hint to where we might find virtue that is stable arises from this problem of steadfast virtue. How do we achieve steadfast virtue? Socrates describes the justice in the Republic as unstable, and I think we've experienced that in ourselves. At least I have. Maybe you all are. I don't know what it's like here. You all seem great. Even though someone was eating enough. Who's that? Was eating food for two? Okay. I'm just kidding. She had to make clear that she wasn't. Socrates describes the view of justice in the Republic as unstable, and yet he himself appears to have tremendously steadfast virtue, right? You get this just from the story of Alcibiades in the symposium where he's describing him. In a military retreat, he doesn't lose heart, drop his weapons and armor and run, which was a great disgrace, right? He actually just walks along and nobody will attack him. In fact, he saved people's lives because of his confidence. So he maintains his courage in a time of fear. In an experience of a dream come true kind of sexual temptation, he just seems completely unmoved by his appetite. Through lack of sleep, he maintains his focus and self-control. He's unimpeded by tremendous cold, nor by the threat of death from the city that he loves. It seems that Socrates knows something that gives him a steadfast virtue. All right? But that doesn't really help us much. He seems to know something that gives him steadfast virtue, and yet he declares over and over and over again through the dialogues that he doesn't know anything, or at least nothing that matters. But ignorance itself can't be a solution, right? I could become a skeptic about knowledge, and that doesn't... In fact, it seems that leads you down the opposite path, not toward virtue, but toward vice. In fact, the skeptical approach Socrates attacks directly in the Meno when he declares confidently that pursuing truth as if we can discover it is necessary to make us better people. So Alexander Nemos wrote in a book called The Art of Living, he suggests that Plato saw this unwavering virtue of his teacher, Socrates, and was convinced that this could not arise out of anything except knowledge, an unwavering knowledge. For any belief that you hold that is not knowledge is itself inherently unstable, right? If you have a right opinion, it's unstable because you can be swayed by any number of things. But knowledge is settled. It's got evidence that supports it. And so the anchor that transforms true opinion into knowledge is apparently made up of the reasons that support that belief. And so according to Nemos, Plato's watching his teacher, sees his steadfast virtue, here's his claims to ignorance, and so he starts writing dialogues representing what Socrates is like. And then as time goes on, Plato starts figuring out the answers, or at least what he thinks the answers are, and he starts writing his own dialogues that really represent his own ideas that answer these problems. Now, I can't go down that route because I just rejected that whole thing right at the beginning, right? So I need to find another solution. Instead of this theory of development, I want to attend to the drama of the dialogue. I want to see what's happening, what events take place in the Republic. Specifically, I want to look at a key turning point in the Republic that oddly most seem to ignore. And it's a very important turning point that I think Plato is signaling loud and clear, hello, things are changing at this point. But let me first do a really quick review of what I've said so far. So I've argued that Plato intentionally uses the dialogue form so that we must pay attention to the drama and the characters to really understand Plato. I've argued that the well-ordered soul, as most people see it in the Republic, is inherently unstable. Socrates himself says that. And our own roller coaster experiences with morality, I think, show that this is the case. I've noted as well that Socrates claims over and over again to have no knowledge of the most important kinds of things, virtue, the good, the beautiful, and so forth. On the other hand, many scholars, such as Nehemos, believe that Plato attempted to develop a rational philosophy that would give us the knowledge that Socrates appears to have, and so that we too could be virtuous, happy. And this leads us back to the Republic's well-ordered soul, which seems like an unhappy and unstable state. We're kind of caught, kind of stuck here, right? So how do we figure out the solution? What are we missing? Well, let's look at this turning point. And if you're not paying attention, you might miss it, because it doesn't take up that much space in the Republic. The Republic is a large book, as you all know, 10 individual books. This takes place in the course of about a half a page. So as you move through Book 2, this takes place in Book 2, you find Socrates along with Plato's two brothers, Glaucon and Adamantus, imaginatively building a city to try to discover what justice is within that city. So that then they might apply that to our souls, right, to a single person. As they near what seems to be the end of the discussion, Socrates begins to describe the lifestyle of those within the city. Now, I just want to read this whole exchange. I've written it down here. Exchange between Socrates and Glaucon in full, because I think it's important to hear what he's saying. So this is Socrates speaking, and then Glaucon interrupts in a little bit. First, then, let's see what sort of life our citizens will lead when they've been provided for in the way we have been describing. They'll produce bread, wine, clothes, and shoes, won't they? They'll build houses, work naked and barefoot in the summer, and wear adequate clothing and shoes in the winter. For food, they'll knead and cook the flour and meal they've made from wheat and barley. They'll put their honest cakes and loaves on reeds or clean leaves, and reclining on beds strewn with yew and myrtle, they'll feast with their children, drink their wine, and crowned with reeds, hymn the gods. They'll enjoy sex with one another, but bear no more children than their resources allow, lest they fall into either poverty or war. That's the beginning of Planned Parenthood. Sorry, that's not funny. Okay. It seems, this is Glaucon, it seems you make your people feast without delicacies, Glaucon interrupted. True enough, I said. I was forgetting that they'll obviously need salt, olives, cheese, boiled roots, and vegetables of the sort they cook in the country. We'll give them desserts, too, of course, consisting of figs, chickpeas, and beans, and they'll roast myrtle and acorns before the fire, drinking moderately. And so they'll live in peace and good health, and when they die at a ripe old age, they'll bequeath a similar life to their children. If you were founding a city for pigs, Socrates, he replied, wouldn't you fatten them on the same diet? Then how should I feed these people, Glaucon, I asked. In the conventional way, if they aren't to suffer hardship, they should recline on proper couches, dine at a table, and have the delicacies and desserts that people have nowadays. Okay, let me interrupt the dialogue for a second. You note that Socrates is describing a very simple city in which the citizens enjoy the stuff of life, but they never really have too much, right? They never give in to gluttony or greed or over any other kind of overuse of anything. And Glaucon is uncomfortable with this, and ironically claims that this is almost like a city of pigs, because, of course, if you know anything about pigs, we just throw them anything, right? We'll feed them anything. We don't care what, and they don't care. And we don't feel pressure to offer them a nice home, of course. They sleep in mud and trash, right? People, though, should get more than the simple. They need proper couches, a table, the finest delicacies and desserts of modern Athenian living, right? Now listen to Socrates' response, because he is declaring loudly, again, for all of us to hear, that from this point forward, the Republic is changing gears. Something different is happening. So, and I quote, "All right, I understand. It isn't merely the origin of a city that we're considering, it seems, but the origin of a luxurious city. And that may not be a bad idea, for by examining it, we might very well see how justice and injustice grow up in cities. Yet the true city, in my opinion, is the one we've described, the healthy one, as it were. But let's study a city with a fever, if that's what you want." Now, Socrates then goes on to describe the additional things that the city will need, right? This feverish city, which swells its numbers and it swells the demand on resources. And this begins a chain reaction of developments. Because of the increase in demands on resources, the city must go to war and take from others their land and their resources. Because they want to make the city excellent in everything it does, each person must be devoted single-mindedly to the task that they have. And so a class of warriors must be developed that is distinct from the class of normal citizens. And this is where the auxiliaries begin to form, even though at this point they're called guardians, but then that divides. And so it'll be a class whose sole focus is honor and victory. And so this feverish city divides into classes, goes to war, and because everyone in it is desiring more than is necessary for their happiness, they eventually require the authority of the guardians, the philosopher kings, who run all things with rational rules. Not only that, but several other strange things arise in the city. It is founded based on the so-called noble lie, a myth told to try to trick people into staying where they belong. The auxiliaries and guardians can have no property, not even knowing who their children, parents, or brothers or sisters are. Their sexual relations are chosen by a rigged lottery. Poetry can't be allowed in the city, and philosophy is meant only for a chosen few who are forced to lead the city despite being the very ones who don't want to run it. Right? This doesn't seem like a utopia. This seems almost dystopian, right? And it's hard to take Plato seriously if you think he believed this is what a just city looks like. But he doesn't think this. He has Socrates state emphatically, the true city, in my opinion, is the one we've described, the healthy one. Well, let's study a city with a fever. And all things, when they are what they really are, in Plato's ideas, participate fully in their form, and thus also participate fully in the form of the good. Thus, if the healthy city is the true city, the new feverish city is not a true city. And so its justice, too, won't be true justice. It won't be the form of justice we have described, but an echo, a slightly garbled image. The true city is careful to avoid war, which is a path to, of course, if you understand what's happening in book one, the talk about justice is benefiting our friends and hurting our enemies. Isn't that what war is? And that's the first thing that appears. It appears in less than a page from the time Glaucon interrupts and says, we need more. Within less than a page, you're at a war and a warrior class. And yet in book one, that kind of stuff was supposed to be completely excluded from justice. And so we need the kind of war where, and it's not just war either, it's not defensive war, it's the kind of war where we need more stuff, so we go to our neighbors and take their stuff, right? So this casts a shadow over justice as it is described from that point on in the Republic. Even the division of the city into three parts starts with the need for war. The necessity of war leads to that first division of the city into two, which eventually leads to the city being divided into three, which may never have taken place if Glaucon hadn't interrupted and demanded more. Right? In fact, it seems that in that original city, there was no authority structure at all, at least from what we can see. Whatever we said of justice in the Republic, indeed whatever of moderation, wisdom, and courage, lies under this shadow cast by this turning point. It's as if what we see is a feverish, foggy image of whatever real virtue is, and thus it is unstable because it's not the real thing, just as every image of the true good is an unstable image, whereas the true good is unchanging in Plato's ideas. So if Socrates was steadfastly virtuous, his virtue cannot have been of this feverish form. All right? You all with me so far? I really need a drink of water. So, all right. So at this point, perhaps you're wondering, and in fact, I think most of us who think this way are wondering and a little bit frustrated that Socrates allowed Glaucon to interrupt. Why does Socrates allow this shift of talk from the healthy city to the feverish city? Because if he would have just told Glaucon to shut his trap, he could have gone on and described justice as it really is. So why does he allow Glaucon to push him around like this? The reason is, I think, fairly simple. Glaucon no matter how good of a guy he was, would be unwilling to listen. Plato brilliantly hints toward this in the introduction of the Republic, which it is said Plato rewrote the introduction to the Republic countless times. He kept scraping, combing out the wax and rewriting it and combing out the wax and rewriting it. And yet, what's the beginning of the Republic like? I was on my way up to the, I just went down to the Piraeus the other day, and I was on my way back up to Athens, right? I'm not quoting it, but it's basically like that, right? So Plato is seeking to make his way up from Piraeus. Piraeus is the harbor city that Athens used. Up from Piraeus to Athens with Glaucon. But a group of friends stop them from going up and demand, jokingly but symbolically, that unless Socrates can overpower them, he'll have to stay down at the Piraeus with them. And Socrates says, isn't there another alternative, namely that we persuade you to let us go? And they answer, could you persuade us if we won't listen? Well, we won't listen. You better make up your mind to that. And this is all friendly banter, of course, at the beginning, but it serves to foreshadow what is to come. It's represented again in the myth of the cave, in which one who has gone up to see the sun comes back down to try to help those who are trapped in the darkness, looking at shadow puppets. But they refuse to listen, and so he must stay down with them. And in fact, they actually end up killing him, right? Because they cannot conceive that there is anything that does not fit into the categories with which they are familiar. The only things they know are the shadows. And so when he starts talking about this other stuff, they refuse to believe that it's there. And so you see this in Glaucon. He rejects Socrates' view of the city. Why? Because it would be uncomfortable, almost inconceivable for someone like him, who is used to the comforts and extravagances of modern living, to go into a city like that. So let's change the question from why does Socrates allow them to bully him to why does Plato include this in his story? Why does Plato have this event happen in the Republic? It's unlikely that the Republic is a true account, you know, in all the details. It's a lot for some guy to remember. Why does Plato include it? Why doesn't he have the interlocutors be great and virtuous people with which Socrates dialogues about the nature of justice itself? Well, the answer, again, is perhaps simple. It's because the best of us is like Glaucon, and the worst of us are more like the troublesome interlocutors like Thrasymachus. Or to state the problem more fully, the kind of answer we are demanding arises directly from our vice. And this is maybe a very, this is kind of a big and offensive claim I'm making here. We are looking for Socrates to give us an answer to what justice is because we are vicious people. That's why we're demanding that kind of answer. And I'll have to say more about that in a little bit. When I get to the end, hopefully that will make some sense and you won't throw stuff at me. So there's a short little dialogue called the Clitophon, which, despite being of questionable authenticity, says something important. It's basically a guy named Clitophon just ripping into Socrates for failing to fulfill the program he starts. And this is the last sentence of the Clitophon, and he summarizes what he says. He summarizes, "For I will say this, Socrates, that while you're worth the world to someone who hasn't yet been converted to the pursuit of virtue, to someone who's already been converted, you rather get in the way of his attaining happiness by reaching the goal of virtue." Clitophon could be voicing the complaint of most of us. Of course, it may be that something is actually wrong with Clitophon, and therefore there is actually something wrong with us. We're not looking the right way. We believe that virtue is found in a particular sort of way, and the answer must come in a particular sort of way, but maybe virtue cannot be had that way. Maybe virtue is a different sort of thing that we can't grasp in this manner. We want the virtue that Socrates had, and we want it in the form of knowledge, but Socrates claims to have had no knowledge, which means Socrates' virtue cannot have been knowledge. Could it be that looking for knowledge about virtue is itself a sign of our feverish desire for more? That seems kind of strange, right? Especially for Plato. So Socrates gives to his interlocutors the best that they can handle, and the best that they can handle is the dictatorship of the rational over the appetites. In fact, that is precisely what they need, for they were apparently in love with their appetites a bit too much to believe that a city without delicacies and couches could be livable. So what would Socrates have said had they been agreeable? What if Plato had written indifferent interlocutors, good guys who are really seeking virtue in the way Socrates is? Well, I'm not sure. And we find this event all throughout the dialogues of Plato, where it seems like Socrates might be getting to the point of telling us something, and then something goes wrong. Where Socrates wants to pursue the nature of virtue, but something interrupts. And so you see, for example, in the Meno, they seem on the edge of talking about virtue, but Meno's lack of self-control causes him to force Socrates to talk about something else. And the Euthyphro, the young know-it-all, has finally reached the point of maybe realizing that he doesn't know, but he's in too much of a hurry to carry on the dialogue. In the Charmides, the conversation is hijacked by the pride and manipulation of a couple of the interlocutors. And the Protagoras, the narcissism of the sophist, keeps the conversation from progressing into meaningful truths. In the Symposium, we get a figurative image where Socrates is about to praise a guy named Agathon, whose name is connected with the idea of good. Agathon means the good man and comes from agathos, the Greek for good. Socrates is about to praise him. And in this image, he stands up to praise him, and right then this mass drunken mob comes in and just disrupts the whole party. An image of humanity's lack of self-control keeping us from hearing about the good. Over and over, human weakness, primarily that of pride, gets in the way of the truth, whatever that truth is. Of course, the subtle implication of what I'm saying is that our pride, too, gets in the way of our understanding Plato. Pride seems to be closely linked to propositional knowledge. Right? You can get that in the Bible. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up, right? Which means you shouldn't be teaching anything in the school. You should just be nice at each other. Now, to describe what this problem is and to make this case is beyond the scope of this paper, and I would, you would all be shuffling out here quiet. You're trying to sneak out to get me to stop talking. But let me try to piece together a little bit of what Socrates may actually have said about the virtuous city and the virtuous soul. If we could get that Glaucon interruption out of the way, as much as maybe can be said. So I'm going to make about 4 points. First, feverish justice, insofar as the word justice applies to it, does reflect in some way real justice. As I noted earlier, and if you know anything about Plato, you realize that everything participates in the form of whatever its name is, roughly speaking. So healthy justice is true to the form of justice. Feverish justice is still similar to healthy justice. It's just like an image. It's a reflection, maybe, you know, like in water where it's a little bit distorted, but you still kind of get the idea. And indeed, throughout the Republic, justice keeps being connected to the idea of harmony among the desires. Socrates claims that this new city, this city that's divided into the three and are working together is creating a harmony and forming a harmony. Keeps bringing that up over and over and over again. And that's surely something we can build upon. Justice seems to have this element of harmony to it. Harmony of our desires being in harmony with one another. Second, it seems evident from what is said about the healthy city that everyone in the city knew what they needed for survival and enjoyment. Right? This is what was described before Glaucon interrupts. They sought to acquire no more than that, and in turn, each member of the city focused on the work for which they were especially well adapted and sought to do that with excellence. Each of these citizens represent our desires, whether they're desires for truth or honor or food. They all have a purpose and an excellence within that purpose, and insofar as they are all seeking that excellence, they will find themselves satisfied without hardship. That is, instead of, I'm more satisfied if I'm seeking excellence in my activity rather than demanding that someone give me happiness. You see the difference? And it's when things start to get bent out of shape that I need more. I should be perfectly capable of fulfilling my desire for honor without having to win everything I do, nor without having to turn every single thing into a competition. I remember helping some of my relatives move, and for some reason, we turn that into a competition. Who's going to carry the most and the fastest? You know, my roommates in college, so we'd be killing ourselves trying to carry a bunch of stuff. If I must always win, or I get really angry and frustrated, then my desire for honor is demanding more than is necessary, because it's not seeking excellence. It's seeking something else. It's actually seeking the wrong thing, even though it looks a lot like seeking excellence. And the same goes for all the other desires. Eventually, it leads to war if my desires go that way, right? A battle with everyone around me. Of course, for our desires not to demand more, they must be satisfied. This is the real problem. If my desires are not going to keep demanding more, they have to be satisfied somehow. And yet they never seem to be satisfied. They're always coming back demanding more. And we always seek to get however much more we think will satisfy them, right? A little more fame, a little more money, a little more fun, a little more power, a little more respect, a little more knowledge, a little more sex, a little more amusement, a little more food, a little more vacation, maybe even a little more work, a little more than my neighbor, right? Always more. We always want more. Why are we never satisfied? That seems like a pretty serious problem for us. Why are we never satisfied? If we appeal to some of Plato's other dialogues, particularly the Symposium and the Phaedrus, we find that our lack of satisfaction arises because our desires never actually taste what they want. Right? You're not going to quench your thirst drinking out of the ocean. So what do they actually want? Well, if you know anything about Plato, the answer is easy and almost completely useless. Our desires want the good, capital G. For all things, from the stuff of our imagination to the things of the world to the truths with which we reason, all these things come from the good and are understood by the good. What exactly does that mean, though? Okay, so let me stop. Let me back up a little bit and go through what we've got so far. So far we have that there is a harmony, whatever that looks like, and that as opposed to the feverishly just city, this harmony is based on every desire tasting what will in fact fulfill it, which is the good in which all things participate, right? Not terribly helpful. I don't know how to write 12 steps to getting there. Let's see if we can clear it up by going through a couple more points. So those are the first 2 points. Thirdly, there seems to be no power structure in that city. There are no authorities. This is prior to Glaucon. There's no division. There's no classes. There's just people doing their things. It's like a hippie commune where everybody's cool with one another. Or maybe an Acts 2 community, right? There's no authorities, no classes, no demands. The rational mind does not need to control anything. But isn't this setup unstable? If the rational mind isn't controlling, isn't that unstable? Wouldn't that lead to people just doing whatever they want? If nothing is there to control our desires, how can we guarantee that they won't begin pursuing the wrong things? But this problem is already answered. If a desire tastes what it really wants, it will not go around pursuing other things. It will stay focused on that one thing, right? The problem is we haven't tasted that thing. And this actually brings us to a fourth point. The city, and this is kind of a development of the first one, really. The city or soul will be in harmony. Let's explain a little bit more about what that means. This is its happiness. The happiness of the city is that it is in harmony, and the happiness of the soul is that it is in harmony. I don't have classes in the city divided against one another, and I don't have desires within my soul divided and fighting against one another. Right? I want to be a good person. I want to appear to be a good person, but I also want to do bad things. And so I have to try to hide, and then I fear shame, and I go, I'm always going back and forth. My desires are always at war with one another. It seems like the best way to achieve a harmony among a divergent set of desires is to have a lot of money and a lot of power and just do whatever you want, right? Like Xerxes. Right? Or maybe some other contemporary people that we could talk about. All right, Xerxes isn't contemporary, but I mean, anyway. He's mentioned in the Republic as an example. But would being like Xerxes or some other famous people right now fulfill our desires? Surely not. Because what fulfills our desires will be the presence of the good, and the good is the one form, the form of forms. It is that in which all things that exist participate. One will achieve harmony only if one sees the good in all things. And so each activity, each moment will be filled with such richness of the good that one ceases to be desperate to get more stuff. And the more you train yourself to get more stuff, like Xerxes, the less you're able to see the good in the thing that you have. In fact, the less you're able to see the good in anything. And I'm going to say more about this, the way we've misunderstood human desire here, in just a minute. The good, then, capital G, brings about a natural harmony, for every desire aims toward the good. Plato says that. Aristotle says that. That's at least one point where they agree. If my desire for sex, money, rock and roll, the truth, food, the health of my children, and the good of my nation, and the success of my school, if all these are aimed toward the good, then as I come to taste, to experience, to understand the good in all of these things, I will find my desires less and less at odds with one another. But I know from what little of the good I've allowed myself to taste that if I were to live like Xerxes or one of those other people that we talk about these days, I would lose even the tattered image of harmony that I've come up with. The good, also known as the beautiful, with Plato, is the aim of all of our desires, from the rational desires to the appetitive desires, the appetites. And so these desires need to be set free, not constrained, but set free to pursue the good / beautiful fully. Restraint is only necessary when one is ignorant about what one really desires. But even this isn't exactly the case. I've criticized the various views of Plato that I think are erroneous, and now I have to explain what I said about Anscombe's view, critique of Christianity at the beginning. So I think this is important, and it actually gets to something that Plato says. I can't say a lot about it, but I'm going to say a little bit, and this is how I'm coming to the end, I promise. The end is nigh. So we have a problem of looking at happiness as the acquisition of some object or state of affairs, as you might say in philosophy. Put more pretentiously, but precisely, our desires, the way we look at things is our desires have their goal, the coming true of a state of affairs describable in some proposition. A proposition is just a sentence that's true or false, right? That is, I want the proposition, Travis is really rich, to be true. Right? I want the proposition, Travis defeats all of the people who stand against him, to become a true proposition. Right? That's what we think our desires are. Right? I'm hungry. I desire the proposition, Travis is eating Thanksgiving dinner, to be true. Right? That's the way we understand desire, and it's bad. It seems normal, and actually philosophers have failed in this. It's a great book by a guy named Talbot Brewer that writes about this. And he's trying to respond to the critique of Anscombe. So our happiness is not found in our becoming something, but in our remaining the same, but having things added to us. Does that make sense? So I don't want Travis to be different than what I am. I want to be what I am now, but have a bunch of stuff added to me, like fame, money. I won't say the other stuff because this is being recorded, right? So that's generally our view of desire, and that undermines our ability to get happiness, to achieve happiness. And so our means of getting these things added to us is through doing things that are not part of our nature as well. Right? I'm getting a little bit strange here maybe, but because these things don't change anything about me, they're just adding stuff, my means of getting them is not through anything changing about me, it's through me acting in a way disconnected with my nature. Right? The sophists of ancient Athens said there's basically two rules about the world, two laws. There's the law of the jungle and the law of man, you might say, or nature and convention is how I'll just use it. There's physis and nomos, nature and convention. Nature determines what truly satisfies us, while convention is what we have to do because we live in society. And so and it's really unrelated to our nature. We act in accordance with convention in order to get what we want. So I smile joyfully at random babies in order to get elected. My natural desire is power. Convention, though, says I have to look like I like your stupid kids. Right? Convention is just the hoops I have to jump through to get to fulfill my physis, my nature. Our view of the moral law is that of convention. Maybe it is convention with a capital C because it is given by God, but it is nevertheless external to our nature. And in fact, this, you probably all heard of the Euthyphro problem, this is what leads to the Euthyphro problem, is the disconnect between the moral law and our nature. The idea that we look at the moral law as convention. Virtue ethics declares that morality relates directly to our nature. In fact, it's nothing but our becoming what we are, fully what we are. That's all it means to be a good. It doesn't mean you're adhering to some law. It means you're becoming what you are. So think about how we tell the story of Christianity, as evangelicals generally speaking. There's a moral law that we broke. This makes us naturally bad. Naturally terrible creatures. Jesus paid the price for the law, and now we are free from the punishment, though we are still naturally terrible creatures. And our goal is to try, for some reason, even though we're forgiven, to try to resist the temptation of our nature, to resist the temptation of our physis, our actual real nature, to resist the temptations of those desires. And if we persist, then in the end we'll be given stuff that makes us happy. You see how all of that's disconnected from what we are? It's all taking place out here. In the symposium, the probably mythical teacher of Socrates named Diotima declares that we don't want to get beauty. We don't want to possess it. We want to be in the presence of it so that we might give birth to great things, to excellence, to virtue. That is, we want to be in the presence of the good, the beautiful, so that we might truly live in accordance with what we are. You see the difference there? I don't do good things that I don't like to do so that I can get paid later. I want to be in the presence of the good and the beautiful so that I might be what I really am. And so using the tools of convention, whether that of the society or of the gods, will not get us virtue, and it will not even get us happiness. Happiness simply is true virtue, and virtue is a way that we are. It's a way that we live. It's us becoming what we are. And that is very suggestive. It suggests that if we can imagine the object that will satisfy our desire, then we're probably not actually thinking about what we really want. If you can describe what you want, then it's probably not what you really want, which is a little bit strange. It leads to what Schopenhauer, the very depressing philosopher Schopenhauer says, is the evil of existence. Desire itself is suffering, and then when you fulfill that desire and you don't have any desire, that's even worse, right? I desire it to be true that Travis is eating Thanksgiving dinner, but man, I hate when there's a whole bunch of food left and I'm stuffed. When I lose my desire to eat, it's like the worst thing that could ever happen to someone. Well, that's not true. So, what kind of desires have goals that are not quite clear and are ever growing and developing and yet are always fulfilling us as we're doing them? Can you think of something like that? It's a desire that's constantly, it's a desire that you have that while you're participating in the act to fulfill the desire, it's being fulfilled, but as it's being fulfilled, the desire is growing and your understanding of what you want is ever developing. What kind of desire is like that? Learning. Oh, growing the school, yeah.
We want more students, and we get them, and we want more students.
Right. Well, are you sure that's not a desire for money and power? I mean, those desires are always trying to jump in, but that's one example, right? Something like this vision of, and worship. Who said worship? That's a good church answer. But it's the case. As you worship, you come to know God. As you come to know God, you want to know God more, and you want to praise Him more. And as you praise Him more, you come to know Him more, right? And you never get to the end of knowing God. I don't think we'll ever get to the end of knowing God. That's the great part. You'll always be learning because every relationship is like that. The most obvious example is friendship. What do you want when you want a friend? If you want someone who's just a support for you, who you can gossip with or whatever, you're not wanting a friend. You're wanting some kind of object, right? What do you call friendship where you have a very clear goal set? I want this, and then when I have that, I'm done. Any guesses? Well, it's a business relationship or prostitution, either one. And that's basically what we're talking about, right? But a real friendship, you don't really know what you're aiming for, right? And as the friendship develops, it's like the goal you thought you wanted has kept receding, and it's becoming more exciting and more beautiful and richer, because you never quite know what it is you want, but you always know the direction you're going. You're always pursuing it. And those are the most fulfilling desires. In fact, everything feeds into that. All the law and the prophets is summed up in what? Love. Love God, love your neighbor. Right? Yeah.
Is this kind of what Paul was going to do in Romans 6, 7, and 8?
Yes, I think so. I think the struggle that we always have with the law is that we see it as convention, as a means of getting what we want, right? What's the first sin? Is it really about eating a piece of fruit, or is it about being like God, knowing the law, knowing good and evil, right? If I know good and evil, then no longer is my nature called to change. I'm instead standing, I push God to a distance, and we interact on the conventional level, right? And immediately they start blaming, they start externalizing the problem. She did it. That serpent did it, right? I think what Paul is struggling with is the heart of sin in humanity, the obsession with convention, strangely enough, which always separates us from people. We don't meet.
It's almost like when he gets to 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation.
Yes, and if you look at all of Paul's letters, almost all of them start by saying what you are, and it says because this is what you are, act like what you are. Not you need to obey the law or you're going to go to hell. He said, "Don't." That's
to the saints, not to the sinners.
Yes,
okay.
And he called. I'm not a saint. What is he talking about? But I am, mm-hmm. not by my power, right. Because that would be convention again. Mm-hmm. And so. But back to Plato. I'm almost done here. So a friendship is one, the pursuit of beauty, both in seeking it out and in creating it. As you seek out beauty, you begin to act to create beauty. But really, friendship and the pursuit of beauty are just ways of describing Plato's view of philosophy. Marriage is one. The pursuit of virtue is one. The desire to know that grows out of the state of wonder. All of these serve as examples, right? And there's also specific examples in each of our own lives, in the activities that we participate, in which we participate, right? Like the growing of the school. But the thing is, for most of us, these are hard to care about because, like Glaucon, we have a hard time imagining living without the delicacies of modern life, right? We got cat videos, especially for our young, right? Social media is such a distraction. But even for us, right? Because what starts out as a good desire can get corrupted, right? So I become frustrated with my wife. And I start thinking I've got this pretty much figured out and I'm pretty much done with this marriage. I'm ready for something else. Right? We start thinking like that because we have so many, right? I keep seeing Victoria's Secret commercials and stuff like that and I forget what I'm pursuing because those other things are brighter and right in my face and I become ignorant of the good and I just want to consume and eat. Right, I want to possess. Right, Simone Weil says that the beautiful is that which we desire without wishing to consume it. We just want it to be, and so even philosophers have made this mistake, and it's partly if Anscombe is right, if I'm putting Anscombe and Brewer together and understanding them right, it's partly because Christianity has taught moral law for so long, which is about restraint. Constrain, 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 hold back, hold down, instead of training the desires, showing them, letting them taste what they want, right? Maybe for some of us, though, and we always begin this way, right? How do you begin with children? Do you say, pursue what you want? You're like, no. That's the first thing a child learns. No, right? Because they don't know what they want. And so we need that rational constraint. And sometimes in our lives, we're always going to be coming back to this, right? I don't think any of us is going to be like Socrates, completely like Socrates, as he's described by Plato. Who knows what he was like in real life? Or completely like Jesus. But we should always be aiming toward that. And how do we do that? Well, we might think that it is by training the rational mind to recognize the good, but it's not necessarily just training the mind to recognize the rational good and therefore constraining the desires. It's about training our desires. So if Plato is right, perhaps the single most important takeaway for education, since I'm speaking to a school and I work at one, the purpose of real education is never simply to acquire more information. You guys know this, you're a classical school. But rather letting the desires taste the truly good, the truly beautiful, so that they might recognize what they really want. And that's hard against the loud pornography-like nature of our society. We may want to fall into the simpler enforcing of convention, but conventional virtue is always unsteady. It will not be maintained. It will fall apart in time. And so we can never stop there. We must always speak to human nature and encourage virtue by drawing out what the desires really want. And in this way, the harmony of the soul, which we call justice, will come to individuals. And so too will follow, of course, wisdom, courage, and moderation. All right. I'm done. And we have a time for questions if you would like.
So this has been bothering me ever since I read St. Augustine's little book on Christian teaching. In book two, when he's making an apologetic for studying things outside of Scripture, he says, if there's anything that the Platonists, the followers of Plato, have said that's good or in consonant or is consonant with our faith, we should not only claim it, but we should take it away from them because it's rightfully ours and not theirs. So in this instance, I'm not attempting to gag you, but in one sentence, sort of a short sentence, what is it that we learn from Plato's Republic that is good and is consonant with our faith that is ours to keep in the midst of all the other shadowy, unstable reflections of virtue and the good that are described in the fevered city? So tell me what's good that we need to keep here.
Well, I think perhaps the best thing is the recognition that what we are called to is not division within ourselves, but harmony within ourselves. And I know that may not be helpful, but this actually really helps. I mean, if Plato, I hope Plato's right because he's really transformed my view of Christianity, which sounds dangerous. But it's because I was trapped in a view for so long in my life, I couldn't break it. I knew there was something wrong with it, but I couldn't figure out what the question was, what the problem was. And what I discovered was, I was trying to hold myself in place by virtue of this rational assertion of the law. And to me, I don't know, to be honest, I don't know if there's anything in Plato that you can't find in Scripture. I think Paul's struggle in Romans makes sense. I think the book of Matthew is a dramatic depiction of the shift from law to virtue. But it's hard to see because we ourselves have been so long in this view that it's all about, we have a very, and I need to be careful here because this is treading on dangerous ground perhaps, but we emphasize so much the legal aspect of salvation that we don't even understand. Like, I don't even know when, it's hard for me to figure out from what I was taught in church how sanctification has anything to do with justification, right? I'm saved by saying the magic prayer, and I walk on the cross across the cliffs, right? And what happens then? I want the same things I used to want. Am I not supposed to do, well, Jesus forgave me, so I'm forgiven for all my sins, past, present, and future, so am I not supposed to do them? Am I supposed to? Why? And if you look at Paul keeps saying, You don't do those because that's not what you are anymore. You've actually, there's an ontological shift, right? You are a different being than you once were. And you're like, well, why should I care? And that's the question. And then we're thrown into Glaucon and Adamantus' criticism of Socrates, or the gauntlet they threw down. And Socrates, what he's trying to describe is, this is all happiness. And so is there something here that's not present in Scripture? There's something in here that I could never have seen in Scripture had I not read Plato. I don't know if that's a great answer, but that's how it worked out for me. I would never have seen it because I've been so trained to read the Bible in a particular way that I probably wouldn't have been able to see it. And now I see it everywhere. It's in the book of Mark, it's in the book of Matt, it's in Paul, it's in Psalm 119. Right? How in the world does this guy have such a love for the law? That doesn't make any sense. It's because he's seeing something through the law. Right? We've misunderstood what the law is. So, and that is, another way of saying it is, the law speaks to our hearts. It actually is written on our hearts because it's connected with our nature. It is what we are. We've been changed so that the law doesn't even need to be stated anymore. You just
That is it's love. It's what we actually want.
And
what
it becomes,
we actually want, and the problem that we think we ought to be opposed to the law is because we don't know what we really want. What we really want is the good. And you keep saying the good is what is the origin and end of things, and all things participate in it. It's hard not to hear St. Paul when you're saying that.
Yeah, and that's actually what Augustine says. He said, I can't remember the quote exactly, but I saw this stuff in the Platonists, but I never saw that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And that's the beauty of the gospel. It's almost as if Plato was asserting something because of epistemological reasons that suddenly gets thrown in front of our faces. The Word steps down out of heaven and takes on flesh and dwells among us. And you look at the beginning of the book of John, it's hard not to hear, too, what's going on in Plato.
Wasn't that the same time period in history? I'm like, I have a horrible view of history. Wasn't that the same time period, though? Wasn't the Sermon on the Mount and all that right in the middle of Socrates' Plato?
No, Socrates died in 399. Oh. Plato was he was pretty young still. He probably lived to, I don't know, to the low 300s. Okay. But it was a little bit later, but a lot of these ideas were infused in that society, even though Epicureanism and Stoicism was the main thing at the time, as you see with Paul in Athens when he goes there in Acts 17.
So it feels weird talking this because I can't hear it louder, but I am told that it is important to have this microphone.
Right.
When you're speaking about, and since Augustine has been brought up, I kept thinking about his most famous quote about our hearts being restless until they find their rest in him.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, isn't that then just Augustine trying to resolve this dissonance that Socrates, that he would have been so familiar and trained with, and that, yes, we have these desires and we're divided in our being, but as Augustine came to find out personally, the good was God himself, and God was the resolution of that dissonance.
Yes, and this flows through a lot of the philosophers. Augustine, Kierkegaard, right? To Kierkegaard, to be divided is what sin is. That is despair, that is sin. It's the sickness unto death is what he calls it in his famous, very, very difficult to read book. And this is a common sort of thing. And what can unite all of our desires? Only that which is the object of every desire, right? Otherwise, our desires are running after different discrete things. If there's one thing that fulfills all of our desires, which we don't do because we're Gnostics nowadays. We've been infected heavily by Gnosticism and we want to throw off the body, right? It's one of my soapboxes, but you go to a funeral and people praise God for salvation. The body's right there. From what I remember, the tomb was empty, right? There's no body in it. They're not saved. We're awaiting the resurrection and the resurrection of the body, right? And so we normally think we're going to have rational desires with God. All right, we'll sing, I like to say to my students, we sing algebra at him or something in our minds, or we mentally sing algebra at him. But no, we're actually, you know, when it talks about feasts, maybe that is actually food. Why not? We have bodies. So Anyway, yeah.
Trying to figure out how to formulate this. This is just interesting for me because when I'm talking about virtue with my students, it's usually in regard to more of the Roman concept of virtus and Machiavelli and how the Renaissance writers looked back at prowess.
Right.
How they kind of redefined it to mean this concept of prowess and how this has come down to us in modern day and how, you know, I think the understanding of virtue today is one of the most important concepts in Western civilization. How do we define virtue? Mm-hmm. Do we define it as the Romans did, as Machiavelli did, personal prowess, or do we define it as you've been talking about today, this more Platonic idea, this striving after the good? And how do we retrain society to reclaim a more a better understanding of what virtue really is? I mean, how do we reclaim that as a society?
I mean, that's difficult because Socrates was trying to do that and he failed. Arguably, Plato tried to do it and he failed. Socrates tried to do it and they killed him. And he had so many people talking about over and over and over again through the dialogues, the idea of power comes up, right? At the beginning of the Republic, it has to do with their capacity to restrain Socrates. It's understood. In fact, so many of them thought of it as the capacity to get things done, to accomplish some end that you're trying to achieve, which sounds a lot like the prowess idea, right? Whatever end I'm trying to achieve, I get it done well, right? Is it a technical side of, kind of knowledge, or is it purely rational knowledge? What kind of thing is it? And Socrates keeps shutting all of that down. He's like, it's not any of that, because that's connected with the idea that what makes me happy is getting something. But that's not what makes you happy. It's not getting something that makes you happy. It's being something that makes you happy. Our problem in our society, let me make this dramatic and kind of maybe offensive, maybe not offensive, but tricky. Part of our problem is science is so successful. And what is science but the power over? We master the world. And we have mastered it. We can go to the moon. We're probably going to go to Mars pretty soon. I can have air conditioning, which is the greatest thing ever, down in Alabama particularly. This gives us a sense that we will eventually even master ourselves. We'll be able to achieve eternal life, right? How can you argue with such, with that view that having power, having the capacity to bring some end to pass? How can you argue against that view when there's so many exciting things coming up, right? Now, we haven't found the thing that makes us happy yet because we're as miserable as we ever were, but at least it feels good while we're miserable. And you know what? There's always the next thing that's coming tomorrow, right? We're in this frenzy. And I think probably one of the things that we need to do to redefine it is we ourselves need to slow down. And we need to find where happiness lies because we're the same way, aren't we? I don't know if Christians are that much different. We look like everybody else.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think so. I think one of the greatest writers for this has always been C.S. Lewis, who admitted that he was very Platonic. I mean, he said in his writings that Plato was the first philosopher to kind of turn him back towards Christianity. You probably are well aware of this. But, you know, turning back towards Christianity, you see that all over in his writings with this concept of sensucht and joy and whatnot. So, I don't know, maybe encourage people to read more C.S. Lewis, perhaps.
But C.S. Lewis is very countercultural. The abolition of man, he appeals to the Republic a little bit. But even that, like, you read that and you're like, wow, we are in the midst of this. And I think it's connected, at least in Plato's view, with the idea that happiness comes through getting something. Like, that's kind of one of the basic ideas. We need to go against that, but we don't. Because I'll preach that, and then I'll go buy a 45-inch 4K TV or whatever, right? Because I think that's going to make me happy. You know,
do you think that the younger millennials are, I'm not saying that they're turning back to Christianity, but do you think that they're turning at least to a Platonic idea? Because with the many houses, and I have two sons in college, they want nothing. I can't get them to get a new pair of shoes when one has a hole in it. They have no desires for, they're majoring in the liberal arts. Their dad is worried about how they're going to make a living. They don't care. They say to me all the time, what do I need? Do you think that there's about to be a generational backlash against the excessive materialism that we've seen in the country since the 80s?
Yes. I think that's already begun. And you see it in a lot of things, right? There's a lot of people turning to an attempt to grab a hold of ancient tradition is a part of it. Like, there's something about the modern world that's dissatisfying, people are realizing. And it might be connected with a lack of optimism. You know, my parents, my dad's down visiting, and his generation always talked about how they worked hard so that their children might not want like they did, right? My dad's fairly old. And so that doesn't exist anymore. There's no hurrying up toward a materialistically successful future. It's all about, it's just like we've got there, we have everything we want, but I'm not happy. And part of that might just be the classic element of we need to rebel against our older generation. But that might not be, and I don't know if there's necessarily good motivation, but I think there's a recognition of the emptiness of what we have now. Even the emptiness of the way we often do church is starting, like, I remember, and I know we're in a, this is, maybe I shouldn't say this, I was a Presbyterian, that's pretty close. But I remember, I grew up in a very low church setting, and I walked into a conservative Episcopal church, and it was like they didn't give a lick how I felt. It was so refreshing. It's like I was standing in the presence of something so awesome that they did not care about pleasing me. We sang all 19 stanzas of this hymn by John Chrysostom, and while we're on our knees, and I'm like, man, this is uncomfortable. Wow, there's something here, right? And meanwhile, we're busy trying. Well, what program are we going to do to make people excited and be cool? No, maybe what we should do is actually recognize that we have something awesome that we're worshiping. Because if you ever noticed, if you go to any kind of public place and there's a bunch of people going, you're going to look. Maybe we're just not looking. We're like, man, there's a really awesome thing, you know, up above my vision. It's super awesome. And everyone's like, why aren't you looking? And I don't think we're looking. I think that might be part of the problem.
Both those sons are going to, and they grew up in this church.
I don't know anything about this church. Except
they do. So. And they're both going to churches where they say it's much more formal. The music is much more formal, much more liturgical than, you know.
And that may be a sign. And I'm not saying that there's something necessarily wrong with this because it can be present in all churches. I just think in many ways we're not. We settle into convention very, very easily. It might be the original sin, right? And it's so easy for us to fall into it. And then we find ourselves dissatisfied. So,
I had one more question on a more practical note, just because a lot of times if we are ever discussing virtue or thinking about it, it's in disciplining students. So we see them acting in a way that's not consonant with Scripture or not consonant with virtue. We're not consonant with God, who is the good.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe we're not thinking about that at all. Maybe we're thinking it's just not consonant with our handbook. That happens too. But it seems to me from what you've been saying that what Plato wants to call our attention to, and it's not antithetical to the gospel, is that our students are misbehaving because they misunderstand what they want. And maybe they haven't seen what they ought to want. Mm-hmm. So in disciplining them, you have children. So what's a practical way of helping our students, of helping our children, to see past the false goal of their desire to what they really want, which is God? You know, like C.S. Lewis said, we're like children who are happy making mud pies because we can't imagine what a holiday at the beach means.
Right.
We just don't desire enough. We don't desire the right thing, the good thing.
Yeah, he stole my thunder before I got here. I think I think that's hard to say, because in a way we all need conventional law in some sense. The law is a blessing and a curse, right? It's a positive and a good. There's this point where it's saying, no, that's not the right way to look. Stop looking that way, and kind of slaps our hands. But at the same time, we always rise up against that. Right? Nietzsche has this great bit in his Genealogy of Morals where he says, punishment never teaches you to stop wanting the thing. It just says, you just have this thing, something went wrong here, right? I didn't achieve my, I just become more clever, right? And so that's the danger of punishment. Like this rehabilitation stuff, you don't go to jail for rehabilitation. At least it doesn't seem like it. So how do we do this? Well, I think convention still declares something. The feverishly just city still tells us something if we are trained to see it. And I think, this is almost redundant talking to a classical school. I mean, as I walked in, I saw talking about truth, the good, beauty and the good, right? For, you know, I don't remember exactly what it said, but something like, if you are, how do you train? Will you show them what is excellent? Right? Instead of just saying that's wrong, you kind of have, and we have this in our language, you're better than that, right? Isn't that how we talk to our kids sometimes? This isn't who you are. And to try to show them, really, to see themselves. And so a lot of it has to do with, and I think, we don't have time for this with all different punishments and so forth, but to sit down with them and almost do a Socratic dialogue with them, to talk with them in this way. Look, what do you want? Because I think just a few questions can get people to recognize that, right? But I think a lot of it has to do with recognizing. Maybe I should say this: the desire that they have is not a bad desire. It's just aiming at the wrong thing. But fundamentally, I think it is a good desire. I will draw on the board. I always draw this image for my students, and I don't know if it's perfectly accurate, but it's as if all of our desires are initially, they're all wanting God, because that's the only way they're going to be fulfilled. And so we have all these desires that are aiming up toward God or the good. But what's happening is they keep getting bent, and that's why they're never fulfilled, because they never quite get to the thing. And when we draw, or when we do law, it's like we're stopping. You need to stop here. You need to stop here, because we're trying to keep the trajectory somewhat still aiming toward the good, but that's never enough. What we have to do is we have to get past the behavior and start talking about this.
And we're trying to get through the math lesson and to go out in the hall and ask the four questions that are going to solve the problem is going to distract us from trying to accomplish the task.
Yeah.
And we've talked about this. Some of us don't even know half of what you've said today because we've never read it, but because we teach little ones. And so I think we've talked about over and over and over again, if we would just take the time one day to do that with that one student, it would solve that one math lesson you just didn't get to finish later. But
the problem is there's always one student.
Doing the right thing is almost always time-consuming and exhausting.
Mm-hmm. And the heart of philosophy is know thyself, right?
Right.
Know yourself. And this is the problem. We live at this level here. And that's why we can never settle, and we can never find our rest in God. And so we have to get down to here, but if you're going to get down to here, you got to dig. And sometimes that just means you got to take the time, right? And with my own children, I want to talk with them. What is going on here? I talk with particularly my 11-year-old. My 8-year-old son is still a little more difficult. My 2-year-old, I just talk about whether she wants to be picked up or not. So, but with my 11-year-old, I can really have conversations about this. Why do you think that girl did what she did when she hurts you? Why are you upset about this? Why did you do that thing that you did wrong back at her? What was going through? You know, I can start to get to that a little bit more. But with the young ones, it's no, because that's really all you can do. I think. Yeah, and in many ways, that's what God had to do with me for most of my life. No, right? Because I keep touching the stove. Why does my hand hurt so bad, God? Why do you make my hand hurt?
In exercising that authoritative restraint, do you sacrifice some potential for virtue? Because I kind of picked up on a dichotomy between restraint and freedom in your talk. So
yeah, there is.
So there, you can't. Your expectations may have to be lowered for what a student can accomplish.
If we follow Plato, it may be that restraint is the best we can do, and we do restraint partly in the hopes that the person will eventually come around and see why, and not divorce law from nature. They'll see that this law actually does echo nature, right? The feverish justice is an echo, an image of true justice. But part of it is also to keep them from going so far that it becomes impossible for anyone else to achieve virtue. And sometimes you're just trying to bracket out that person so that they don't hurt anyone else, right? So it's a problem. The problem with it, and maybe I should make this clear, it's almost as if the law serves like an icon. If you start obsessing about the law, it becomes an idol and brings you down. It becomes something you hate and worship at the same time, which almost everything that is not God that we try to worship, we end up hating at the same time. But if you see through it, then you turn into more like Psalm 119, or more like what Paul's writing about all the time, where you actually love the law and you realize that it's all about this love. The issue, and that's the issue with almost every object, if you're not seeing through it, but I wasn't able to get to a lot of it. I think every desire we have is an icon of God's greatness, God's good, God's goodness, God's love and beauty. It's all imaged in these things. And it's our, when we get stuck, right, we're supposed to be looking through it, but then we hit it and we get stuck, and that's where everything gets bent out of shape. You can think of this aiming up, and it rams into something and decides to stop, and it breaks the trajectory and makes it go off in another direction. So sometimes we have to reset. Okay, let's talk about what we really want when we're looking for this. But that's really hard. When I was 16 years old, I talk to my class now at college when we're talking about Plato, and I'm like, you don't believe me. You don't believe that you actually want God. Partly because of the Gnostic training, which relates to this view of the law, where we almost idolized it. For example, let me give you an example. What is a church sermon like? You exegete the passage, if you have a good pastor, he exegetes a passage, or she, I don't know what logic, anyway, and then you give application, right? Here's the law, here's what you should and shouldn't do. What kind of sermon is one that actually says, you know, this is what you are, isn't that awesome? Look at what you are, and then you just sit down, and you're like, I want to be Spider-Man, right? Or, you know, I mean, you have that call to be great. I want to, William Wallace, Braveheart, right? You watch Braveheart, and every man after watching Braveheart wants to be an excellent human being and defeat the English again. We feel that draw. But you don't get that when you say, you know, you need to stop doing that. Which is what almost every one of our talks with our kids or sermons or anything comes down to. Well, I need practical application, 3 points. I don't know, that's... We fall into Romans 7 then. You know, the law, I want to get out of this. So we do sacrifice something, but I've talked to some really messed up people. And when you start talking about what they really want and what they really are, it's amazing what happens. But sometimes you have to listen, and that's part of the problem. We want to tell people. If you tell people, it's always external, it becomes convention, it turns into law. If you listen... That's what Socrates does when he's talking, by the way. He's always listening. And so it's a different route, but it takes a lot of time. Perhaps you didn't have time to stay and talk. No, but it takes a lot of time, and it's a lot of trouble, right?
From a wisdom point of view.
Oh, no.
From a wisdom point of view, to answer your question, what would be the middle point? What would Christ do? Well, Christ washed feet. Christ died on the cross.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he suffered. He showed humility. I mean, the answer didn't come to the disciples till later, but they could look back on it through experience and said, I'm now old enough to know what he was talking about.
Yeah.
The upside down kingdom now, I'm just talking to me and you. The upside down kingdom now in Matthew came at the Lord God himself washing my feet.
Yeah.
And from a teacher's standpoint, which I'm not much of, I just started, but I have been a stay-at-home dad forever, and I don't remember what my father did. I didn't appreciate what he did for me until I did it to my child.
Mm-hmm.
And my children will not truly understand what I did for them until maybe they get to that.
Yeah.
It's when I pick up my child and kiss them when they deserved punishment.
Mm-hmm.
It's when I remember what my daddy did to me when I deserved it.
And it's also that they see love in everything you're doing, even that you, they see the punishment and they might feel fear and even some bit of hatred, but then they see the love throughout all of it. And they're like, this punishment can't, this no isn't all there is. He actually loved me. He wanted something for me, right?
And that's why in wisdom literature in Proverbs, it's the scene of the father and the son on the knee. The mm-hmm. rabbinic tradition of, I'm going to teach you these things
yeah.
to love the Lord your God, because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
It's daddy to son, it's wife to husband,
yeah.
it's wife to
husband. And I think fear of the Lord actually means being scared of God's punishment. That could be some debate, but Joseph Pieper, he's a Catholic guy. He's a Thomistic scholar. Talks a lot about virtue. He actually says the fear of the Lord begins. There's two fear of the Lord takes on two forms. The early form is actually scared of God. The later form is scared of sin.
Sure. Well, the first disciple.
But you have to start.
Could stop the storm.
Yeah. You start
the
with that
of the
fear.
Lord after the fact, after he rose.
Yes. And then it develops into.
You see how yeah. we can use Scripture and not go to Plato.
not anymore. Any other questions?
Well, I think we're out of time, but okay. I want to thank you for coming to talk to us. And thanks so much.